1. Life in general. Xerxes I, Old Persian Xiarsha, by name Xerxes the Great. Born circa 519 BCE, died 465. Persepolis, Iran, Persian king, 486-465 BCE, the son and successor of Darius I. He is best known for his massive invasion of Greece from across the Hellespont. 480 BCE, a campaign marked by the battles of Thermopylae, Salamis, and Plataea. His ultimate defeat spelled the beginning of the decline of the Achaemenian Empire. 2. Accession to the throne. Xerxes was the son of Darius I and Atossa, daughter of Cyrus. He was the first son born to Darius after his accession to the throne. Xerxes was designated heir apparent by his father in preference to his elder brother Artabazans. A bas-relief on the southern portico of a courtyard in the treasury of Persepolis, as well as the bas-reliefs on the east door of the Tripylon, an ornamental stairway, depict him as the heir apparent, standing behind his father, who is seated on the throne. When his father died, in 486 BCE, Xerxes was about 35 years old and had already governed Babylonia for a dozen years. One of his first concerns upon his accession was to pacify Egypt, where a usurper had been governing for 2 years. But he was forced to use much stronger methods than had Darius. In 484 BCE he ravaged the delta and chastised the Egyptians. Xerxes then learned of the revolt of Babylon, where two nationalist pretenders had appeared in swift succession. The second, Shamash-Ariba, was conquered by Xerxes' son-in-law, and violent repression ensued. Babylon's fortresses were torn down, its temples pillaged, and the statue of Marduk destroyed. This latter act had great political significance. Xerxes was no longer able to take the hand of, receive the patronage of, the Babylonian god. Whereas Darius had treated Egypt and Babylonia as kingdoms personally united to the Achaemenian Empire, though administered as satrapies, Xerxes acted with a new intransigence. Having rejected the fiction of personal union, he then abandoned the titles of King of Babylonia and King of Egypt, making himself simply King of the Persians and the Medes. It was probably the revolt of Babylon, although some authors say it was troubles in Bactria, to which Xerxes alluded in an inscription that proclaimed. Xerxes thus declared himself the adversary of the Devas, the ancient pre-Zoroastrian gods, and doubtlessly identified the Babylonian gods with these fallen gods of the Aryan religion. The questions arise of whether the destruction of Marduk's statue should be linked with this text proclaiming the destruction of the Deva sanctuaries, of whether Xerxes was a more zealous supporter of Zoroastrianism than was his father, and, indeed, of whether he himself was a Zoroastrian. The problem of the relationship between the Achaemenian religion and Zoroastrianism is a difficult one, and some scholars, such as M. Millay, have even thought that this is an improper posing of the question, that there were, rather, three different states of religion. A religion of strict observance, a royal religion as attested by the Achaemenian inscriptions, and the popular religion as described by the Greek historian Herodotus. 3. War against the Greeks. With the tranquility of the empire re-established, Xerxes would willingly have devoted himself to peaceful activities. But many of those around him were pressing for the renewal of hostilities. His cousin and brother-in-law Mardonius, supported by a strong party of exiled Greeks, incited him to take revenge for the affront that Darius had suffered at the hands of the Greeks at Marathon, 490 BCE. The impressionable Xerxes gave way to pressure from his entourage and threw himself into patient diplomatic and military preparations for war, which required 3 years to complete, 484-481 BCE. Herodotus notes that never before had such an effort been undertaken. Troops were levied in all the satrapies, and a navy, intended to be the army's supply line, was gathered. The care lavished on this enterprise shows that the king did not regard it as a minor operation. There has been much later speculation on the real causes for the expedition. They could not have been economic, because Greece was not important then. Perhaps it was only the manifestation of the royal absolutism. Xerxes, whose character was later distorted in Greek legend, was neither foolish nor overly optimistic. Although sensible and intelligent, he was nevertheless, according to G. Klotz, at the head of his armies. He left Sardis for the Hellespont and had two boat bridges placed across the strait. A storm destroyed them, and Xerxes had the sea whipped as punishment. With the bridges remade, For 7 days he oversaw the crossing of the army. 5 million men according to Herodotus and 360,000 by modern estimate, supported by 700 to 800 ships. Their passage was facilitated by a massive engineering works. A channel was dug across the Isthmus of Actium so that the peaks of Mount Athos might be avoided. Nevertheless, the army's size was of no help, partly because of misinformation about the enemy terrain and partly because of the appearance of a national feeling in Greece. After a few successes, for example, Thermopylae, mid-August 480 BCE, Xerxes occupied Attica and pillaged Athens on September 21. But on September 29, at Salamis, a naval battle that he had initiated turned into a defeat. Without a fleet to take supplies to the army, he had to retreat. He crossed over into Asia, leaving Mardonius in Thessaly. During an indecisive battle near Plataea on August 27, 479 BCE, Mardonius was killed, and his death obliged the army of occupation to withdraw. Hostilities continued for 13 years, but thenceforth Xerxes involved himself only slightly. 4. Withdrawal to Persia. Soured by this failure, which modern historians consider the beginning of Achaemenian decline, Xerxes retired to Susa and Persepolis. He then furthered the depletion of the once enormous resources he had gathered, through multiple taxation, by launching a vast construction program. At the capital city of Persepolis, Darius architects, working from a unified plan of great scope, had already begun construction on a gigantic terrace of the Apadana, an audience hall, the Tripylon, a palace, and a treasury. When Xerxes became king, he had laid the enameled brick facing on the exterior of the Apadana and finished his father's palace. Then he erected other monuments, his own palace, southeast of Darius and similar to it in plan, and a mysterious building called the Harem by archaeologists, a line of small, identical rooms that may have been Xerxes' treasury. He also undertook construction of the Hall of 100 columns, or throne room, but he was able to finish only the paving in the base of the walls. The walls themselves and the decoration of this gigantic hypostyle hall were the work of Artaxerxes. These buildings marked an evolution toward the colossal and toward a style that was perhaps more pretentious than that typical of Darius' reign. Little is known about the last years of Xerxes' life. After his reversal in Greece, he withdrew into himself and allowed himself to be drawn into harem intrigues in which he was, in fact, only a pawn. Thus, he disposed of his brother's entire family at the demand of the queen. But in 465 BCE he himself fell, together with his eldest son, under the blows of murderous members of his court, among them his minister Artabanus. Another son, Artaxerxes I, succeeded in retaining power. 5. High of Xerxes. Xerxes, the king of Persia, is portrayed as 7 feet tall. Actor Rodrigo Santoro is only 6'2". Not too shabby, but the other 10 inches are special effects. To look the part though, Santoro had to let go of vanity.